quickly.
The impulse for the observatory came to me during the Magnificat. The tower was conceived in the trenches, under the impact of the word of Einstein's theory. It brought foreboding and great changes. I tried to express my idea in form rather than structure. You can label this series of sketches Magnificat, although I should like to avoid all suspicion of the literary. The representation has nothing to do with nature, for it takes its laws from architecture itself. Dynamic masses are to be shown so that their dynamism is clearly expressed, so that movement and counter-movement show the balance. Between the two coefficients of direction, energies and sounds, stands the sudden transition from light to shade, from black to white. The pauses are the pivots of the movement. They are the impulse, the living element, while the mass is stable. The factory with cranes seems to confirm this utterly. according to the way it is built up, this mass can be mighty, oppressive, or finely and sensitively outlined without losing its stability. The pause stands at the point where the movement is to be given a new and unexpected direction. That is why it surprises, why it stimulates.
Erich Mendelsohn, like other expressionist architects, had spent the war years developing a drawing technique with which he could explore the expressive possibilities of architectural form on paper. So far, we have seen Mendelsohn trying to catch architectural form through music. The sketches show ideas which look as if they could never be built. But the amazing thing is that Mendelsohn was able to transform one of his series of visionary sketches into a real building. What is more, a building which really looks like the sketches and retains their fresh, dynamic qualities. In the next sequence, we'll look at some of the sketches which led to the creation of the Einstein Tower, again to a background of the music which inspired Mendelsohn. We start with a series of observatory sketches drawn on the Russian front in 1917.
I live among incessant visions. Their transcendence is such that it often carries me away. It is hard to catch it, and impossible to grasp it fully. To express it in solid terms is the task. But I am glad to be subject to its law, because for me it is the truest life. After an hour of sleep, I suddenly got a bout of drawing fever with a whole mass of sketches, which will perhaps remain spontaneously as they are, or perhaps I will go over them again. Mostly Freundlichian, Tellurian, and planetary things. My sketches are data, the contour lines of an instantaneous vision. The moment of conception remains essential. It contains within it all the seeds. But their sympathetic humanity can only come in the development. It is always the same with drawings. I do not really know if it is because of my inclination towards the fantastic or my habit of putting down millions of schemes on paper. But I have to compel myself to limit and to transform my over-diffuseness into tension. This is why I want to put aside the Magnificat drawings, although I've been successfully occupying myself with them. Decorative weaknesses always come into conflict with structural requirements, and it is only out of such chaos that the final result can emerge.
Mendelsohn was clearly developing his ideas about architecture under the influence, or the impact, as he put it, of Einstein's ideas. When Mendelsohn wrote down his ideas, he was absorbed with the problem of designing an astronomical tower to fulfill a specific function in astrophysical research, and at the same time to symbolize the grandeur of the Einsteinian concept. Mendelsohn had to turn his prolific ideas into a precise building, which did not lose the expressive qualities of the sketches. In 1917, he defined three conditions or ways of visualizing architecture. Let's see how the theory of 1917 fits the finished tower of 1921.
The dynamic condition, the movement of space, to visualize its linear elements by means of its contours.
We can see how the linear elements of the sketch are expressed in the sweeping vertical and horizontal contours of the tower. Mendelssohn's dynamic condition can be seen in this play of vertical and horizontal forces.
The rhythmic condition to visualize the relation of the masses by means of the projection of surfaces.
This may seem difficult at first, but we can clearly see how the dynamic condition of the building, the play of horizontal and vertical forces, is penetrated by the curving shapes of the stair windows and the sweeping arches which buttress the back of the building. These surface projections and recesses can be seen as a separate element to the dynamic condition. They're related in the same way as rhythm and melody in music. But at the same time, all these movements can be seen to balance each other, which leads to Mendelssohn's third condition.
The static condition, the equalization of movement, to visualize this as elements of construction by means of ground plan and section.
Whereas the first two conditions, the dynamic and the rhythmic, define the sense of movement in the building, the static condition shows how the tower is built on a stable constructional basis. The equalization of movement Mendelssohn speaks of can be seen in the symmetrical and strong axial layout of the plan. This section too shows the strong horizontal and vertical elements which equalize or stabilize the building. It is remarkable how the theoretical notions and the actual building tie up. The Einstein Tower was not a scatterbrained fantasy, but the painstaking and brilliantly successful result of a long-cherished dream to create a new architecture without obvious precedent. Oskar Beyer, a German art critic who met Mendelssohn after 1919, records in his unpublished memoirs the functional purpose which the tower had to serve. It was, he wrote, designed to house the coelostat in the cupola in such a way that it reflects the rays of light sources vertically through the full height of the tower into the laboratory in the basement. Here, the mirror at an angle of 45 degrees reflects them to the spectroscope. This, its main function, did not necessitate a large-scale building, although the actual building appears bigger and more monumental because of its shape. It looks aggressive and conforms therefore to Mendelssohn's dominant trend in his sketch designs of that early period. It's surprising how small the tower really is. These photographs of Mrs. Louise Mendelssohn visiting the tower a few years ago give us an idea of the very intimate scale. This is increased by the curving forms that enclose the entrance and the small-scale precision of the surfaces. This entrance area has the streamlined elegance of a deck housing of a small cabin cruiser. When we look at the building, we keep seeking analogies. In fact, it looks like anything but a conventional building. It's much more like an object, a piece of diabolical machinery, or a work of expressionist sculpture. Beyer wrote that Mendelssohn at the time considered the building as an organism, as a prehistoric creature full of pulsating power. He liked to speak of its skin, which reflects the internal functions, where it bulges or constricts, or whenever it breaks open through its hatch-like windows. Further analogies can be found to explain the complex ideas of architectural expressionism in the concern for monumentalism, towering strength, and cavernous mystery.
Now, I did meet Professor Einstein and his first assistant, Professor Finley Freundlich, who later became the director of the Einstein Tower and was really the inventor of the Einstein Tower. And here was the plan, but there was no money. So I said, I was just building the hat factory near Berlin. And so I said to Professor Freundlich, I said, I have arranged a meeting for Friday night in this little place where the factory was built, and you will meet my client. Tell him everything. What about everything about Einstein? Man didn't understand anything, but he was so impressed that he finally said, "And what will be the outcome of the Einstein theory for my head factory?" And then I came in and said, "Tremendous." This was the man who gave $20,000.
Even with Erich Mendelsohn's explanation, it's not the whole story. The building was as intricate as a Swiss watch, and nothing quite like it had been made before. The smooth external appearance and the apparent ease with which Mendelsohn translated his drawings into reality belie the many problems posed in building the tower. Building contractors had no experience in this curvilinear type of construction, and shipwrights had to be brought in to sort out the curvature problems. The shapes are so complicated that building had to be set out on paper in the same way that a complicated object, like an ocean liner's funnel, for example, is set out for construction. This drawing shows the relation of elevation and plan and gives the hundreds of complex dimensions necessary to build the irregular shapes. But it's more complicated still. The tower tapers as it goes up so that the plans decrease in size. Each stair window has a different plan. Here they are shown set out with their different dimensions. To understand the building further, we must examine this longitudinal section and the plans at each level. The building consists of a tower precisely related to the underground laboratory. This had to be vibration-proof and to contain the mirrors, arc lamps, electric oven, wall for double-action camera, fixed temperature room, and prismatic spectrograph. There was also a room for microphotometrics, and a room for storing batteries, and a dark room. The solid foundations, which you can see on the right, with the extra thick floor, must be part of the vibration-proof conditions necessary for Einstein to conduct his experiments. The plan of the basement shows how it was divided up. On the right is the heavily insulated vibration-proof area. In the middle of the plan is the 45-degree mirror placed centrally in the oblong room with its axis at right angles to the main axis of the building. To the left, there is the ovoid stair hall leading up to the ground floor. This is surrounded by four small rooms with windows that can be seen on the exterior coming through the grassed-over basement. Incidentally, this is an interesting feature. If we look closer at the grassed-over area, we see there are two distinct steps. Now look at the plan again. Einstein and Freundlich clearly needed the space lit by the six basement windows along the top and bottom of the plan. But it looks as if Mendelsohn did not want to make the tower seem bulky at the base and turf this substructure over. The elevation drawing shows the tower sitting on the stepped surface. The room on the extreme left is almost kidney-shaped with two more basement windows. This photograph shows Einstein standing at the window. Scientific equipment rests on two heavy bases which are also marked on the plan. This plan shows the tower at entrance level. Mendelsohn has also marked in the outline of the area enclosed by the grassed-over basement. On the far left, you can see the steps leading up to the entrance. You go up the steps into an open area enclosed by curving walls. You then progress through double doors into the staircase hall, which leads down into the basement. Or you can go straight on into the main tower area. The room is flanked by stairs going up and houses the steel lattice structure supporting the lenses. You see the stairs on the left which continue winding up the inside of the tower. At the base is the hole in the floor through which the light passes into the basement from the telescopes above. The flowing shapes of the room envelop the rigid rectilinear structure. We seem to be inside the belly of a prehistoric monster. The door facing you leads into the office. Here, space opens out into this apse-shaped room, which is lit by 5 windows. Again, the room is curvilinear. The only contrast to this is the very angular tables and chairs. Sinister and reminding one of the Expressionist set for a film like The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari. On the exterior, the windows are set in these deeply cutaway splayed arches that eat into the apsidal end of the building. You may remember that they were clearly visible in some of the sketches, where they played an important part in what Mendelsohn called the rhythmic condition of the surface. On the plan, you can see the depth of these arches and the complexity and irregularity of their shape. The arches, with their substantial piers, act as buttresses, holding up and preventing the spread of the main tower, very much like the buttresses around the apse of a medieval cathedral. The smaller, semicircular window above is one of 5 smaller ones lighting the night quarters, the room above the office. It is a slightly smaller room than the office. The smaller windows and lower ceiling make it seem more enclosed and suited for nighttime occupation. At this level, the building has shrunk to contain just this one room and the tower. Its left flank now takes on a concave form with eye-like corner stair windows. 4 stair windows mark the height of the tower. Just below the cupola is a rounded window facing towards the entrance. This lights the top story, which houses the ciliostat. Above this is the cupola with its opening doors, telescopes and lenses. On the exterior, the copper bronze cupola dramatically crowns the tower, contrasting with the white undulating surfaces of the rest of the building. The vertical thrust of the tower is held down by the horizontal bands round the stair windows and the sweep of the base. This play of forces again calls to mind Mendelssohn's dynamic and rhythmic conditions of architecture. The restlessness of the early sketches inspired by music is caught in a frozen moment, in the physical solidity of the building. At first glance, you might expect the building to be anything but functional or even modern. It may have struck you as impractical or even bizarre, but it's amazing what a clear and precise statement the building really is. Firstly, it is as precise as a scientific instrument and neatly packages the facilities necessary for carrying out scientific experiments. It is also amazingly clear as a piece of construction, and in the way its surfaces and lines are translated in reality from the sketches. The building becomes an extremely clear statement, its form being perfectly compatible with its function. This justifies the Einstein Tower's fame as a cause celebre of architectural expressionism. In 1921, it was an uncompromising challenge to architecture and still remains so today. But there are still daunting technical and logical difficulties in completely abandoning the rectilinear basis of architecture. Mendelsohn later referred to the members of the Bauhaus as having rectangular minds. The Einstein Tower stands today as a challenge to the rectangular mentality.